Welcome all, and I'm excited to let you know that we're going to be building a brand new Sega Game Gear this video. A big shout out goes to Matt and BennVenn for the assistance of this build. A link to their Discord will be down in the description below. With all that out of the way, let's get to this video. For this build, we'll be taking this glitchy mainboard riddled with jumper wires as our donor. Let's remove this LCD and CFL lamp from the mainboard so that we can have better access to the board's components. Since this thing is a lost cause, let's grind off the cartridge connector post so that it can be released from the mainboard. While there is a small chance of melting this cartridge connector if we're not paying attention, let's see if we can shortcut the process and take a hot air station to it.
One eternity later.
And it looks like this slot wants to be stubborn when it comes to being repurposed for our Syf Game Gear. Let's take a different approach and suck up all this solder with the braid. Then we'll revisit it with our hot air station to persuade it to leave. Now that our cartridge connector is off the board, let's remove all the hidden oxide decades of neglect has collected upon it with some white vinegar. This game port will be treated the same way. After sucking up the majority of the solder with the wick, we can go over the remnants with a hot air station to break it free. Just be aware that under the game port is a plastic spacer that'll cook if you do it this way. Technically, we don't have to add flux to this ASIC we're removing. I'm only adding it to keep an eye out for the dark brown color, indicating that something isn't going our way. Now that we have harvested all the parts for our Game Gear build, let's tackle the elephant in the room. If you plan on attempting this, I highly suggest that you practice on a junk board to get a feel for what works and what doesn't given your soldering level. Given that my soldering skills are on par of a 3-year-old, I opted for tinning the pads and running a hot air station over it in hopes of a quick win. This damp sponge was a helpful suggestion by Matt to help solve the inevitable bridges we'll be clearing. Despite the ASIC being off a little bit, those eagle-eyed amongst you will probably notice that the ASIC is installed in the wrong orientation. For this second attempt, let's use flux for its tackiness so that the ASIC is less likely to move around on us. After aligning our pins carefully, we can use this bent conical soldering tip and tack it in place. We're not going to be bothered about bridges for the moment. We just need the ASIC to stay in place for the time being. While some people may prefer drag soldering for this job, if you're new to soldering, I'd recommend against it. When I was practicing on a junked board, I routinely bent the pins of the ASIC. Running the iron lightly in the ASIC pin's direction prevents the risk of bending or knocking them out of alignment. For clearing bridges, we'll be using a wet sponge to clean the iron before grabbing more solder. If the solder isn't flowing on the iron after a few sponge dabs, simply reapply some flux and you're back in business. One thing to note about this ASIC install is that I had some floater pins on each corner that wasn't making a solid connection. Make sure to double and triple check your work. If you still can't diagnose the problem with the ASIC, a reflow with the hot air station could cure your woes. To install the power and sound cables, you'll notice that we have this notch on the cable indicating the side of the first pin. Fortunately, this board has pin 1 clearly stamped on it to avoid any confusion. To install our LED indicator, we'll be placing its longer positive leg into the hole marked A. I really like the nice soldering iron for this kind of work, because it can reach both legs at the same time. Usually I twist these legs off with a pair of pliers, but since we're going to be showing off our work, we can use these snips instead. This crystal doesn't have any polarity, so we can install it in any orientation. And just like our previous component, we'll be cleaning it up the same way. Let's not forget to solder the wiring harnesses that go to the power and soundboard while we're at it. And this game port will be installed in the same manner. And this cartridge connector was a bit more tedious than I expected. After using a set of tweezers to get all the pins to align in their holes, let's grab some tape so that it doesn't pop out before it's tacked to the mainboard. Once both sides of the cartridge connector have been tacked, we can simply discard the tape and finish up the other pins. This potentiometer is dealt with the exact same way. If everything goes to plan, the LED indicator should turn on and we'll be able to hear a game. Since everything is installed except for our screen, let's snap this scored section of the PCB off. Of course, Matt thought of everything with this main board and included this BennVenn helper kit to aid in our installation. To prevent this helper board from sliding around on us, let's temporarily hold it in place with this tape. Now that it can't get away from us, let's flux everything down and get it attached to our display. One thing to be mindful of is that plastic clip on the ribbon connector. Melting that with an iron could net someone a bad day. After 3D printing the LCD bracket for mass sight, we're now ready to mount the BennVenn screen and finalize our installation. Because its ribbon is slightly longer than needed, let's trim the end of the connector in half to give us a cleaner install. To get the other end of the ribbon cable to mate up with the BennVenn display, we'll need to make a 90 degree bend like so. After some back and forth with BennVenn on its helpful Discord, we forced the LCD on using these two points. Being that the LCD's backlight was on but no picture was displaying, it was determined that a more deliberate solder connection to the display would be needed. The rest of this install is up to personal taste. For a moment there, it felt like I was dressing this Game Gear up like an 80s Mattel toy. Finally, after playing musical buttons, I settled on this treatment for the Game Gear. And there you have it. Arguably the cleanest looking Game Gear on the planet, and one that stands out amongst the rest. And that about does it for this video. If you like this content, or if you have any questions or comments, go ahead and leave it down below. And as always, I'll see you next time. Since you're still here, chances are you're really digging what this channel's cranking out. That's why I have a special announcement. Through your support, this channel now has over 100 subscribers. Without your feedback and constructive criticism, this channel would be nowhere near where it's at now. To show my gratitude, I'm gonna give one of you guys a Game Gear that'll be featured in the next video. To be entered in this raffle, all you have to do is leave a comment down below. You don't even need to be subscribed. It could be criticism, support, or even an idea for a new video. Really doesn't matter. And if you arrive late to the party, I wouldn't worry about it too much because I plan on giving more stuff away in the future. I really can't overstate how grateful I am to you guys. So thank you. With all that out of the way, I'll see you in the next video.